One of the fundamental concepts you will learn as a calculus student are the integrals representing the signed area underneath the graph of a function as we sweep through a given input range. Here, we begin by approximating the area with a bunch of rectangles between the input range and then crank up the number of rectangles within that input range to infinity to make our approximation increasingly better. The inputs here are one-dimensional, real numbers lying along the x-axis. But what if the input space itself is two-dimensional and the area swept underneath the two-dimensional function as we travel along some curve on the xy plane is now no longer flat? Is there a way we can generalize integrals of single variable functions into multivariable functions? Line integrals is the answer to this question, and they come in two flavors, one for scalar fields and the other for vector fields. In this video, we'll dive into line integrals for two-dimensional scalar fields. Scalar fields are just functions that take multiple inputs and return a single output. The inputs in this case are the coordinates of points on the xy plane. One way to visualize this function is to raise points on the xy plane by a height equal to the output of the function at those points. This results in a surface in three dimensions. For line integrals, what we are interested in is the area swept underneath this surface as we travel along some curve on the xy plane. Take a moment to digest this figure. Our ultimate goal would be to somehow transform this curved area into a flat one so that it can be evaluated just as another single integral. This video is mostly a guide for this transformation process. Our curve here is defined by the parametric function r of t equals t, 2 sine of t for values of t ranging in between negative 3 and 3. Just like we did for single integrals, we'll begin by approximating this curved area with a bunch of rectangles lying along those points on the curve corresponding to the evenly spaced samples between the t limits whose width delta t is 1 for now. We will let it approach 0 in a minute. The lengths of these bases, which we'll label delta s, have two components, delta x and delta y. Applying the Pythagoras theorem, delta s is the square root of sum of squares of these individual components. The heights of these rectangles are the function values at the starting points of the bases, which can be obtained by plugging in the parametrization for the curve into the function f. So our approximate area is the summation f of r of t times delta s. We will now crank up the number of rectangles along the curve to infinity to make our approximation increasingly better. This is a regular drill in calculus, which is when we replace the summation with an integral. Notice that the integral sign has a C written at the bottom to emphasize that we are now integrating along a curve. Now, although we do have an expression representing the area, it is not at all clear how we can actually evaluate this one. I mean, the integrand is a function of t, the integration variable is s, there are no integration limits, there is just no clue how to evaluate it. Under these circumstances, integrating with respect to t seems to be a promising idea, and for good reasons. We already have the range of values for t, which can potentially be the integration limits. Also, the function representing the heights of the rectangles is already in terms of t. What we are really trying to do here is to express this integral as an integral with respect to t of some other function g of t. Really take a moment to think about the underlying geometric significance behind this. It is really satisfying if you can figure it out yourself. If I give you a rectangle of size a by b and ask you to construct a new rectangle of same area but with a width of say w units, what would the height of that new rectangle be such that the area is preserved? Equating the areas of two rectangles, the height of the newly constructed rectangle is a function of the original area, A times B divided by the width W. In essence, we are rescaling the given rectangle such that its width is always W units and the height is such that the area is preserved. And guess what? That's exactly what's happening under the hood with the equation here. I'll reduce the number of rectangles for clarity. We'll crank it back to infinity in a while. This equation is asking for a new set of rectangles, all of which are bound to the condition that their corresponding areas are equal, while their widths are now equal to delta t. In essence, we are rescaling the original rectangles to match the new width delta t. So the new heights g of t are f of r of t times delta s over delta t. Substituting our expression for delta s, we now have a function of t representing the new heights. Now the only thing left is to crank up the number of rectangles to infinity to make our approximation increasingly better. Delta t now approaches zero as a consequence. And when delta t approaches zero, the ratios delta x over delta t and delta y over delta t are nothing but their respective derivatives with respect to t. And that's it. We now have expressed the curved area just like another single integral. Just for verification, if we use Desmos to define our parameterization, their derivatives, and the new height function g of t, we get the exact same result. Alright, that's it for this video. I hope that it served its purpose. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.